Hey everybody, so it's the year in review and 2017 has come and gone. And now I am here to talk about my favorite things that occurred this year. So please, check it out. Who knows, it might change your life. After all, trust me, I'm a professional. I'm serious. I'm pretty amazing. 2017 had some of the best films I've seen in a very long time. Now, I want to have a disclaimer. There were many films that I did not get a chance to see this year, such as I, Tonya, Dunkirk, Lady Bird, Baby Driver, and Darkest Hour. Movies I wanted to see but never got around to actually watching them. I just want to say this because last year, during my 2016 video, I didn't mention some movies that would ultimately turn out to be some of my favorites of that year. So this list is always workable. I'm basing this off of the movies that I actually saw, and this year there were many films that I truly enjoyed. Some of my favorite movies this year included Logan. While not flawless, it's an intense and atmospheric story of loss and pain immersed in graphic violence. The soundtrack to this was awesome, and even though it kind of fell apart for me a little bit towards the end, I still really enjoyed this movie. Blade Runner 2049, a visually stunning movie to the point that it was mesmerizing and it was astonishing. It was just a very pretty movie. Gosling delivers a nuanced performance that delivers in a bleak and wondrous dystopian world. Wonder Woman. It's every bit as magical as people wanted it to be. Gal Gadot is breathtaking as she charmingly explores a new world, and it's an absolute treat to experience it with her. I'm very happy about that film. It was surprising, had no interest in watching it, but it's a refreshing remake that rides that 80s nostalgia train while expertly combining hellacious horror with real humor and heart. The kids really sold this movie. It wasn't so much of a horror movie, it's more of a bunch of kids just hanging out and having to fuck up a demon-ass clown. Also some documentaries. Batman and Bill, a Hulu exclusive, is the incredible story of Bill Finger that really captivated me. It's a documentary with style, passion, and justice. I learned a lot about the history of Batman. Get Out! It was entertaining and thought-provoking. It was social commentary that was both hilarious, but it was also terrifying. Shout out to Rod, that TSA agent, he knows how to handle shit. And then Thor Ragnarok. It had a lot of fun towing the line between fantasy spectacle and alien sci-fi cyberpunk. It was big, it was weird, and it was really fucking funny. Oh, and then James Franco. God, The Disaster Artist is a poignant comedy that is charmingly offbeat and eccentric. It doesn't mock Tommy Wiseau, it instead pays homage to the importance of friendship and the power of following your dreams, while being expertly funny. The Room was a cult hit, such a weird movie, and this film really sheds to light its central meanings. And then there was Bright. And Bright was a pleasant surprise. I had no interest in watching this movie whatsoever until, again, Steven forcing me to do things I don't want to do and then changing my life forever. It's a wild cop drama with interesting world building, strong emotion, and excellent chemistry. Ward and Jacoby are great together, and this is a movie that I've watched on Netflix at least 4 to 5 times already, just because it's so much fun. And then there was Justice League. Now, I get it. People didn't like this movie. And you know what? I didn't love this movie either. But that's the word. I didn't love it. I did enjoy it. But it's still one of my favorite films because it had some legitimate, entertaining, and funny moments with an impressive aesthetic. It feels like a comic come to life. That's what it was. Like Suicide Squad. I thought even though, you know, it did have its flaws, it still felt like a comic book movie. Like this is a comic book I was reading by someone. And that in itself was cool. And there were a lot of great moments that made me like it no matter what. So the Justice League, I thought, wasn't the best movie, but it was one of my favorite movies, and I'll watch it again and again. The actors really bring these characters to life. The chemistry is what sets this apart from everything else. The heroes are great. The narrative could have been better. I don't know why they fucking used Steppenwolf, but I love this movie. However, though I loved all those movies, all of them pale in comparison to my favorite movie of 2017, and that is Saban's reboot of Power Rangers. A story centered in unlikely friendships, a contemporary superhero breakfast club with fun nostalgia. Okay, so many people didn't really care for this movie, but when we talk about representation, amazing acting, a fun vibe, and just a reboot that reimagines and brings in a whole new generation of kids to enjoy the Power Rangers, I thought this movie was very successful. To me, it was everything that I wanted in the reboot. Jason, Trini, Kimberly, Billy, Zach. All of these characters were brought to life by these new characters, these new kids who came in, these actors who brought new, fresh life into them. And so overall, Power Rangers was my favorite movie of 2017, to the point where I bought the film 3 times, because they were exclusives through Target, Walmart, Best Buy, and so I had to get all the different accessories. For all its faults, 2017 was a year of great television, whether it be a Netflix original, a show exclusively on HBO, or a show you could watch with cable. There were so many great television programs this year. Some of my personal favorites include Stranger Things 2 kicked it up a notch with new characters and old 80s jams to add to this thrilling series collection of unfortunate events. The chemistry between the characters and overall story were great follow-ups to what made the first season such magic. It kept what worked and added new elements to make it feel different. We had King Steve Harrington, the official mom to the kids, the father and daughter dynamic between Hopper and Eleven. Poor Will, she just can't catch a break. The Eldrazi fucking with the Stranger Things kids, Bob the superhero, and Eleven's venture into a live-action X-Men cartoon for a whole episode. It was a show that just kicked ass. Season 2 really delivered, and I'm glad that they did it, because I love this season. Though only 7 episodes, Game of Thrones Season 7 was explosive and relentless. Characters died, alliances were made, unlikely foes joined forces, and it all revolved on the long-awaited encounter between Jon and Dany. The fans had high expectations, and it really fucking delivered. Netflix gave me the violent and gritty Punisher series I had so desperately wanted to see since Jon Bernthal played the character in Season 2's Daredevil. The story was one told before, government conspiracy slash revenge porn, but the cast did a wondrous job that felt emotional and jarring. The Punisher was violent fun, and Jon Bernthal really delivered the performance of his life. Some critics didn't like it for some reason, but it was a really, really good show, and you know, don't take my word for it, go see it. It's free on Netflix, and by now everybody should have a Netflix account, but if not, just let me know, I'll let you use mine, because this show is worth watching. All in all, my thoughts and feelings are perfectly described by Defiler Worm on Tumblr. Defiler Worm states, "What I expected out of The Punisher, generic, stereotypical, hyper-masculine white male revenge fantasy. What Netflix gave me, an incredibly sad and highly nuanced story about PTSD, loss, grief, family, blood and found, conspiracy, and the ways the government fails and betrays our service members and veterans, with a heaping side of bloody violence." That's right, Defiler Worm. That's right. BBC One and FX fucked me up with Tom Hardy's mesmerizing and unsettling 8-part period drama, Taboo. Just one day, it was on the TV, I'm like, you know what, I'm gonna watch this. And it is profoundly dark with an intense aesthetic. It's a mysterious and brutal look into the vicious conflict between the devil James Delaney, the East India Company, and the British Crown in 1814. This show is fucking slow. The ultimate slow burn, but the remarkable performances by Hardy and crew, as well as the thematic music and scenery, keep you glued to the TV. This was a pleasant surprise, and I am so happy that I watched this, because it'll fuck you up. It's a really great watch, and one of those shows that I just needed to watch again and again. However, even though these were great shows, no other program was as fun, as emotionally rewarding, or as satisfying as the Netflix original, Glow. This is a show that perfectly balanced a cast of likable underdogs into the world of professional wrestling, and it all seemed impossible. Talk about women's wrestling. But with Chavo Guerrero Jr. as wrestling coordinator for the show, it felt authentic, it felt vulnerable, it felt real. I found myself overcome with the most powerful emotions of elation watching Allison Brie, Kate Nash, Brittany Young, Mark Marone, and all the others that had to overcome obstacles by embracing the wacky ridiculousness of wrestling. Not afraid to poke fun at itself, I think this was by far the best show of 2017. I remember I started the show and I just couldn't stop until I finished it. This hit so many emotions for me, and I loved it from start to finish. Moreover, Darren Furnish from Entertainment Weekly, I hope I said your name right, I'm sorry, gives an excellent review of why Glow is the best show of 2017. He states, it's 1985, and women dressed like spandex cartoon characters are wrestling. This is just kind of silly, says one wrestler's husband. He's almost right. It's the silliest, smartest, greatest TV event of the year. Creators Liz Flahive and Carly Mensch returned to long-ago TV history, the glory days of syndication, to create the streaming age's pop epic. Alison Brie is struggling actress Ruth Wilder, who joins a gang of wannabe lady fighters. With the best cast on television, it's a hilarious misfit gang romp, but Glow's genius is how the goofy candy-crazy grandeur of this whole endeavor is also an empowering triumph. These women are building a community and declaring ownership of themselves. It's like I'm back in my body, says new mom Debbie, Ruth's best friend and nemesis and co-star, played by walking revelation Betty Gilpin. I'm using it for me, and I feel like a goddamn superhero. The show caught the hashtag MeToo drumbeat early and conjured up a whole team of Wonder Women. In the climactic showdown, Debbie, in character as American heroine Liberty Bell, has to climb to the ring's top rope for her final finishing move. It's just a silly rope, in a silly wrestling show, in a silly old theater, in a silly era long gone. But you feel every present tense moment of that climb, scared but steady, ludicrous and victorious. Rise, Liberty, rise. This show is phenomenal. I've been a big fan of Vela Maya for many years now. And this is one of the few bands that I actually went to go see live during the time that Id came out. So from The Common Man's Collapse, to Id, to Eclipse, to the newer things like Matriarch and the new album False Idol, this band really delivers a lot of the greatest songwriting I've ever heard. And it's a shame because a lot of people have never heard of this band and probably will never hear this band because they're so set in their ideals of listening to heavy music or Satan worshiping, whatever the fuck you want to call it. Metalcore, djent, heavy metal, this is good music regardless. And I gotta say that in 2017, The False Idol, Vela Maya's newest CD, is by far one of the greatest pieces of music I've gotten the pleasure of listening to. It's amazing on so many different fronts, and I highly recommend everybody check it out because it will rock your socks off. False Idol improves on what their previous album, Matriarch, started. It seamlessly blends catchy, beautiful, clean melodies with heavy and fractured guitar riffs and relentless drums to continue their unique rhythm. This CD is heavy, it's catchy, it's glitchy and experimental with techie and disjointed riffs, and soft but powerful hooks. Guitarist Marco Cubo continues to deliver fresh and efficient sounds that continue the band's distinct sound. Technical, sharp, heavy, and melodic. As the band's tour de force, it's nice to know he continues to deliver. Lucas's vocal range has only gotten better since his debut on Matriarch, much more refined and smooth. His vocals aggressively emote throughout the entire record in screams and growls, but he then crescendos into impressive choruses that are catered toward hit singles. It sounds pretty, it's catchy, and it works very well. And then, of course, the record would be nowhere near as amazing without the proficient foundation of Sam and Danny on bass and drums. All four members have a powerful chemistry that produces powerful results. This album is my favorite for a very specific reason. It works. It hits all of the right buttons, and it makes you want to listen to it again and again and again. Some of my favorite tracks on the album include the singles, such as Doublespeak, Overthrow, and Whistleblower. But then other songs like Pool Spray and Citadel and even Fracture. These are songs that hit really hard and they just keep you wanting to have more of these great, great melodies. This is an album worth listening to, and if you haven't checked it out or if this isn't your scene, please reconsider because this album is great in so many different ways. So by far, this is my album of 2017, and if you'll excuse me, I think I'm gonna go listen to it some more because it's that fucking good. This year was all about comic culture, and that's what's really fucking awesome, is the fact that, yes, Marvel has allowed comic book movies to soar and continue to get better, but this year we had even more films from Guardians of the Galaxy 2, to Logan, to Justice League, to Wonder Woman. We had all of these great, great movies, and all of it stemming from the culture that is comic books. And God, 2017 was a year in comic books. First of all, we have to talk about the fact that Tom King probably has had one of the best years that he's ever had. From his Batman, from his Mr. Miracle, to his stories like The Button, Rooftop, Super Friends, all of it has been great, and now it's coalescing all into Doomsday Clock, which is turning out to be really fucking good. On top of that, DC Metal, God, the idea of heavy metal combined with the Batman mythos, creating a bunch of crazy Batman, is insane in itself. DC Rebirth continued with some amazing stories, and Superman leading the charge of powerful storytelling. Also, this was Jack Kirby's centennial year, and Kirby is by far one of the greatest creative minds in superhero comics. So even the fact that Mr. Miracle is out, and it is one of the finest pieces of comics I've ever had the pleasure of reading, now it just goes full circle with building on something that's so beautiful. This was honestly a great year in comic books for me personally, because this is also the year where I really jumped into DC Rebirth's event. I read the entirety of Superman's story, which is some of the best storytelling I've ever had the pleasure of reading. Also, talking about Tom King, I went back and I read all of Grayson, and now I've been able to read through his trilogy of the whole I Am Gotham, I Am Suicide, I Am Bane story, which was just keeping me on the edge of my seat the entire time. I read classics like Batman Eternal and Batman and Robin Eternal. Right now, maybe not looked at as the best necessarily, but I feel they will be instant classics in the future. While DC Comics soared, this was the year where almost everything went completely wrong with Marvel Comics. And that's unfortunate because they had a great MCU year with all of their great movies. But for everything from Secret Empire to Nazi Captain America, they really fucked up. But it was more news that went into the whole machine that is comic book culture. Boom Studios continued to deliver their fantastic MMPR stories, specifically the focus on Lord Draken, one of the coolest new additions to the MMPR mythos. Also, we got Go-Go Power Rangers, which is more of a focus on the teenage life of Power Rangers, and that's been really fun. And then we've also have the Power Rangers teaming up with the Justice League to take on bad guys, which was a really fun crossover. And this wasn't just a good year for DC, I mean there were other fantastic comics going about. We had the surprisingly attentive and witty Flintstones title, we had the insightful The Best We Could Do, the stylized Aliens Dead Orbit, which was really sick, penned to life by James Stokoe, the highly praised My Favorite Thing is Monsters, and then also the disturbingly funny collection of stories by Joanne Cornelas, Zonzo. So, there were a lot of great stories to be read. This was also a good year in Japanese animation. I mean, not necessarily that these came out this year, but I was introduced to the fantastic My Hero Academia, which is by far one of the greatest TV shows and comic books I've ever had the pleasure of reading. This year, Attack on Titan got fucking crazy, and it only continues to get better and better. So overall, Japan also brought to us a lot of great, great reading material. All in all, this was a great year in comic books because there were so many events that I truly loved. Sometimes trying to immerse yourself in a good story is really hard to come by. And luckily in this year, I was able to reinvigorate myself by reading such amazing stories. I know I use these words a lot and they might lose meaning after a while, but these stories will never lose their meaning because I learned a lot. And overall, I'm hoping 2018 will be just as satisfying. There were many great games that came out this year, but none compare to the beauty and the exquisite storytelling of Wolfenstein 2: The New Colossus. Originally, I had no interest in playing this game until Steven, thank you Steven, tells me, hey dude, you wanna kill some Nazis? Let's buy this game. And I said, you know what? By the same people that made Doom, so it has to be good. And it fucking was. So now, don't get it twisted. Don't think that I have a hard-on for Bethesda, id, or Machine Games, because last year, Doom was my favorite video game. But honestly, these guys have been killing it. BJ Blazkowicz and Doom Guy just coming together, ripping and tearing, especially to Mick Gordon's soundtrack, because it's in all of this. So it just encapsulates everything from killing and stomping on demons versus killing and stomping on Nazis, which is pretty fucking sick. So these have created a trifecta of beauty that I just am completely in love with. Make America Nazi Free Again is the tagline to this outstanding first-person shooter, a sequel to 2014's amazing The New Order, Wolfenstein 2 The New Colossus raises the stakes with insane gameplay, laugh-out-loud absurdity, clever and insightful social commentary, and brutal violence. It's exhilarating as you play as the unstoppable Nazi killing machine, BJ Blazkowicz, or Terror Billy, whatever you want to call him, and immerse yourself in a fantasy revenge tale. But it's so much more than just killing Nazis. It also continues an emotional and deep, well-told story on family. The characters are what sells this, and that's why I love this so much. Grace, Max, Anya, Bombate, Caroline, Wyatt, Fergus, Set, Sigrun, Horton, all of them are small players in this overarching story of revenge and family and betrayal and standing up to injustice. This story was so much more than I expected, and I'm very pleasantly surprised, and I'm so happy I played it. This is the best game of 2017 in my opinion, and I loved it so much I went back and I played the New Order. So please, check this game out because it's really worth all of your time. And if you want to kill some Nazis, if you want to punch them in the face, you know, this is a good platform to do it in. It's great in so many ways. Wolfenstein 2 The New Colossus is a truly wonderful, joyous, first-person shooter experience that I think everybody should experience at least once. JV Guantley with Game Informer magazine really puts it in great perspective from the review that this person wrote. It states, Wolfenstein 2 constantly finds ways to turn things up to 11, but that's only half of its magic. The New Colossus does not shy away from tough themes, but instead doggedly pursues them. The 14-hour campaign tackles racism, executions, child abuse, despair, patricide, the Holocaust, and terrorism. While these themes are dark, the game handles them well, giving a proper amount of drama and emotional depth to each. However, this prey of tragedy is never too much to bear, thanks to a fair share of wacky humor. You also see heartfelt moments of romance and friendship among the crew. Amongst all the murder and sorrow, the New Colossus makes room for love and hope. Wolfenstein 2 The New Colossus is a bold game that rages and soars, deftly balancing pulp sci-fi with deadly seriousness, and one that should not be missed by anyone interested in the power of storytelling and video games. And this is exactly what the reviewer hits right on the nail. Wolfenstein is supposed to be fun. It's supposed to be exciting. It is a game surprisingly steeped in controversy, even though the premise of this game for the past 37 years has been killing Nazis. More so being, fascism is not okay, and it's not okay. And right now we've had some very turbulent times, specifically in 2017. And this game is a breath of fresh air, and yeah, it uses satire, but it's also a catharsis. Talking about, you know, America founded on the idea of freedom. And so now, what do? BJ, his power, his willpower, this game is a testament to who he is and how all of us can be like him, and always going not to the extremes of killing people, of course not, because killing people should never be okay, but it's all about being able to provide and view and hope for a better tomorrow and being active about it. Some people can look at it as saying this game is too political. I argue that no, not really, because when we talk about Nazis and Nazism and fascism being okay, then you miss the entire message. Wolfenstein 2 The New Colossus is a fantastic game. Do yourselves a favor and play it. If you haven't guessed by now, I'm kind of into toys. And this year, I got access to a lot of fantastic collectibles that are now part of my collection. Well, last year, unfortunately part of the series, I didn't put my top 10 toys of 2016. Here's a picture of them now. These were my favorite. I love them so much from so many different reasons. And so I thought, you know what? Let's do it this year. What were the top 10 toys that I loved this year? And in no particular order, because it's very hard to pick which ones are my favorites, except for one, which we'll talk about right now. But these are the 10 plus one, because I couldn't keep it down to 10. This is my 11 top toys of 2017. Now let's start this big. The greatest toy that has ever been created and that I got my hands on this year is the Queen himself, Freddie Mercury. Equipped with a variety of microphones, hands, and heads, this is a toy that has descended from the heavens themselves. Attention to detail is very important, and make no mistake, this Freddie Mercury is one of the greatest toys I've ever seen. Not only does it have that iconic look that SH Figure Art provides, but the articulation is off the chain, It's more than Power Rangers. Here we have the greatest songwriter and greatest vocalist of all time. Chris Hemsworth is a very handsome man. And as you can see here in the Marvel Legends Thor Ragnarok that came in the 2-pack with Valkyrie, this is a helmetless Thor Odinson, and the likeness is almost uncanny. That in itself makes this one of my favorite toys. The fact that it looks very grungy in the tribal sci-fi punk aesthetic that he's got going on. The Mjolnir didn't come with this figure, but I put it in his hand anyway because he looks sick with it. And that haircut, just look at that. Look at that haircut. It's a good toy. This is Mattel's DC Comics Multiverse, the Batgirl of Burnside Batgirl action figure. Now, if you didn't see me play with her in my past videos, please check it out now. It was a lot of fun. But I was really excited to get her when I first saw her at Toys R Us because this is a Batgirl that I haven't really had ever. And this is a really cool redesign that I always thought was pretty sweet. But the face and the hair remind me a lot of my friend Ashley. And she actually cosplayed as Batgirl at one of the Suicide Girls fashion shows. Or I think it was a Comic-Con, I'm not sure. But this toy is just really cool to have. And just awesome because it's Batgirl. But the 20 points of articulation and the fun colors are another reason this toy is legit. I started the year right with this NECA Chris Redfield Resident Evil 5 action figure. Not only is it a really good toy in the fact that it's very detailed and it moves very well, but the likeness to Mr. Redfield is really all in. It comes with many accessories. Even though the hand fell off, I super glued it back on, and I'm very excited to have this figure because of the fact of the nostalgia it brings to me. So I'm glad I purchased this at the beginning of the year because it continues to be one of my favorite toys. Another toy from the SH Figuart line to add to my collection, here I have the greatest character in all of Star Wars, the young Obi-Wan Kenobi from Star Wars Episode 1, The Phantom Menace. I cannot explain the feeling of elation I have whenever I pose this toy. And again, SH Figuarts is very infamous for the fact that their toys come with many different hands and a variety of different shapes, sizes, in which I can craft all kinds of stories because of the way they can move. This is nostalgia at its best, and let's just take a moment to see the beauty that is the Jim Lee version of classic Cyclops that we saw in the comics. Now this is all about Hasbro. Hasbro, thank you, because now I have this iconic Cyclops in my Scott Summers collection. Besides the fact that he's very articulated, it's a great likeness, it's very colorful, everything about this toy is rad. White Ranger Tiger Power! Here we got White Ranger Tommy Oliver, one of my favorite of the MMPRs, and here the Legacy Collection has just been killing it. So once again, loving green and red from last year, white is a continuation because not only does he come with a sick Saba, but he's very superposable to give you some of that Kung Fury. Trigun Maximum is by far one of the greatest graphic novels ever put to paper. And so, from reading it, I had to pick up a Vash the Stampede. I mean, who wouldn't? Now, I had all kinds of places to choose from, but they're all really expensive. So on eBay one day, I just purchased the Toy Tribe series by Kyoto, bringing out this awesome Japanese character to life. 22 points of articulation, interchangeable hands, an incredibly detailed base. Didn't get a lot of that, but he is detailed, he comes with 6 shades, and his arm can transform. Not in this toy, but he can. A late Christmas present that I got in January, this is by far one of my favorite toys because it is Akibo Ranger Red. And not only that, but it's an SH Figuarts Akibo Ranger Red. Steven, you really are too much when you give me these very, very well thought out gifts. One of those stories in which I had loved the character so much, and all of the different poses I can put him in, makes this toy amazing. Just take a second and look at this metallic sheen coming off of this Batman toy. After reading Greg Capullo's Fantastic Super Heavy, I had to have Batman Robot Bunny Blue version 2.0 Rookie Batman Mecha Toy because Jim Gordon rocking it inside this awesome proto suit that's supposed to be a police Batman is just fucking sick. It's not very poseable, but the aesthetic is there and that's exactly what I wanted. And he's also fucking huge. And of course, you can't have greatness without the phenomenal AJ Styles. This WrestleMania attire, AJ, that is basically all chest hair, came out this year and I had to pick him up because this is beauty personified. Not only does Mattel give me a very practical figure that can do all of AJ's moves, but also it's a very clean aesthetic where the white, the blue, and the red all work so well together. This detail is exquisite, and this is an exquisite performer. Don't get it twisted, there's only one phenomenal one. And so with that, keep collecting right up into 2018.